The following is a special presentation of ESPN on ABC.
Welcome to College Football, presented by Best Buy. Today from Kyle Field in College Station, Texas, it's the Texas Longhorns against the Texas A&M Aggies. Ron Franklin, Ed Cunningham, and Jack Arute coming to you from a capacity house at Kyle Field. Texas won the toss. They have deferred to the second half, so we will see the Aggies go on offense first as Hunter Lawrence prepares to kick it off for the Texas Longhorns. Franks and Brown, the dual safety back for A&M, and we are underway. It's a high spinner. It's going to come down short at the 16-yard line. This is Brown. Pierre Brown tries to take it to the outside and is going to be knocked out of bounds at the 35-yard line.
Stephen McGee will come out. His first start in college was 2005 against Texas when Reggie McNeil was hurt here in Kyle Field, and it's been not as much about the pass this year as it has been about the run, although he can be effective. I think they had a bye week. Stephen McGee was fairly beat up throughout the season, had 35 carries against Nebraska. I think that bye week, after 14 straight weeks of camp and games, really helped Mr. McGee.
Mike Goodson will open the game at tailback for the Aggies as you look at head coach Mack Brown for the Texas Longhorns. Goodson, a sophomore out of Klein, paid at Collins High School, and they swing the ball out to him, and Texas very quickly on defense will knock him down for a 3-yard loss. Ryan Palmer, the first man to get out there and make the hit. And Dennis Francione on the near side of the field. Some people think it could be his last game on the sideline. We'll elaborate on that more as the afternoon goes on.
And our conversations with him this week obviously wanted just to focus on this. You know, this is about his senior day for these Aggies, looking for their second win in a row against Texas. That's much bigger to him than any news about his future, and he tries to get the focus on that.
Alexander at fullback. The pitch goes back to Goodson. Goodson is hit and knocked down for another loss. This time of 3, and it's free safety Marcus Griffin who came in and got penetration.
Already mentioned that Texas A&M comes in off a bye week, but so does Texas. And when you're getting ready to play what is a triple option team here, just a speed option, you have extra time for your safeties and your corners to work on their run support. That time, excellent job by Griffin getting upfield and stopping the pitch. That's excellent defense against the pitch man.
Third down, A&M needs to take it out to their own 44-yard line. And big Javorski Lane comes in at tailback. 6 feet, 271 pounds out of Lufkin. Now a whistle and a flag.
False start on the offense, number 2. It's a 5-yard penalty, still third down.
Irvin Taylor, senior out of Mission, Texas.
And this is not obviously where the Aggies are good offensively. When they get to a third and very long situation, this is not their forte. Not many offenses are, other than maybe a place like Texas Tech. But this is not what Texas A&M wants to do on their first drive, is be going backwards.
Third down and 20 for Texas A&M. Gonna run. Now gonna throw. Lobs it out, and he's got a man open at the 40. That's Javorski Lane. And Lane may have the first down, and in fact he will at the 45-yard line.
Well, that's a very nice job by Stephen McGee running parallel to the line of scrimmage. It looked like he had committed to the run. And I think all of the white shirts thought the same thing. That's what you expect out of McGee, to think run first instead of pass. But right there, as he started running parallel to the line of scrimmage, you could see the linebackers coming up and leaving Lane alone. And Lane, as big as he is, has turned into a pretty good receiver out of the backfield this season.
Palmer made the tackle. First down, Texas A&M at their own 46. Pass thrown complete, another first down inside the 40 and down to the 38-yard line. That's Irving Taylor on the receiving end of that Stephen McGee pass.
Boy, Stephen McGee looks a lot fresher And you know, he's battled some arm problems. He had a pulled muscle in his arm a couple of years ago. He strained it in the spring. And you get the sense that the coaches feel that week off has really helped him, got him comfortable, and they come out throwing a lot more. They ran two options to start, but now allowing McGee to sling it around, which he did a fine job of in high school.
Aggies this time come out in a two tight end alignment, and they come option to the open side of the field. Goodson, and Goodson is going to be stopped after a gain of three by Lamar Houston.
Well, Mack Brown comes into Aggie land. Very good record against Texas A&M, and looking to become Texas, looking to win 10 games for their seventh year in a row. It's an amazing run that Mack Brown has the Longhorns on, and if they can get a win today and or in their bowl game, it'll be seven straight years with 10 or more wins. Pretty impressive.
Good start from McGee. 3 of 3 for 36 yards so far. Blitz coming from Texas from the short side of the field. Pass thrown complete, and Goodson stays on his feet at the 30, 25, cuts it back inside, and he may score. 10, 5, touchdown, Mike Goodson, 35 yards. Play, you'll see Brian Arakpo about to blow up the whole play. He missed the tackle on Goodson, and it cost Texas 6. Szymanski to attempt the extra point, trying to put A&M up 7-0 in the first 3.5 minutes. So the kick is up, and it is good.
Well, they're going to run the screen, and as it gets out here, it's the missed tackle, but watch the block up top. An excellent job downfield by Michael Corey. There's the missed tackle you mentioned by Arakpo. Good balance, but watch Corey. Knocked his man all the way off the field, goes to chase him, and continues chasing him. That was excellent job by Goodson. He cut back away from him, knowing Corey was going to trail. That's great vision and great balance to get out of that arm tackle.
Show a play that came within a breath of being a loss of 3 to 4 yards, winds up being a 35-yard touchdown.
And when you talk to Dwayne Aquina, the co-defensive coordinator at Texas, this is the guy that he was most concerned about. Mike Goodson did it to him last year up in Austin. He had a 41-yard touchdown run on an option that looked like it was dead in the backfield, not unlike that screen there. But the coaches at Texas said Mike Goodson reminds us of Jamal Charles, the speedster on our group. That's the guy they were worried about.
Stephen McGee perfect on the series. 4 of 4 for 71 yards. Kickoff will go 5 yards deep, and Cosby will not return it. Let's go down to the sideline. The third member of our broadcast team, here's Jack Aru. Jack?
How amped up is Stephen McGee in this Aggie team? Well, after that touchdown, Stephen McGee went all the way down the sidelines, guys, and high-fived every member of the team. There's a lot at stake today. Also, I think it's a tribute to their coach.
You know, and Jack, as difficult as this season has been, Stephen McGee has not flinched one time in a support of his coach, showing up to media day when he has to be in there, answered every difficult question through the email scenario with Coach Franchione. He has not flinched one time. He's been in his coach's corner, and of course, this is as big as it gets.
Colt McCoy opens at quarterback for Texas. Play action. Looking. Going to go long, deep over the middle, and the ball is overthrown. Intended for Quan Cosby, just across midfield, incomplete.
And Colt McCoy has really played himself. If you go back to last year when he had to be carted off the field in Austin against A&M in that loss, the last 5 games for Colt McCoy have been sensational. And a lot of that has to do with the development of the zone read play, again, that was used so much when Vince Young was a quarterback. But that's why Texas has been able to run the ball so effectively in the last 4 or 5 ball games.
So if you just joined us, A&M 7, Texas nothing. 11 and a half minutes to play, and the first carry of the afternoon by Jamal Charles. And Charles is going to have a gain of about 6 yards in the play before Mark Dodge makes the tackle. We need to explain. Mark, the back of his jersey, reads a different name, showing respect for his grandmother and an aunt who have passed away within the past month. So rather than Dodge in the back of his jersey, the number is the same, but the back of his jersey reads Thomas. McCoy throws it complete to tight end Jermichael Finley, and he will have the initial Texas first down of the afternoon at the 31-yard line. Devin Gregg, the free safety, is there to make the tackle for Texas A&M.
Jermichael Finley has really turned into a weapon. A nice balance for Jamal Charles, who's been on a tear. And that was a nice route. He actually ran that on Mark Dodge. He ran right at him, then broke it out and made a nice run to get the first down.
A&M showing blitz off the corner, but they stay at home. Charles looks for a spot to run, and he'll take it out to the 34. Gain of three. It'll be second and seven. Michael Bennett is there to make the stop on Jamal Charles.
And of course, Jamal Charles, 2 weeks ago against Texas Tech, tweaked his ankle a little bit. The coaches said that the bye week really helped him. Came back, and he has been on an absolute tear. He's getting close to the 1,500-yard mark on the season, which is quite phenomenal because he was basically benched for a few games in the middle of the season for a fumbling problem.
From a shotgun, blitz up the middle. It's picked up. McCoy throws the ball complete. Stepping out of bounds is Finley. And Finley had room to step up enough to pick up the first down, and I'm not sure he realized that at the time.
Exactly what I was thinking.
It's going to be just over a yard that they'll need to pick up the first down on third.
There's Finley right here. And when he goes out into his route, he's just kind of finding and sitting down. McCoy sees him the whole way, but I agree that he turns back to the inside. He probably picks up the first down.
Charles right up the middle. Doesn't matter. He will have the Texas first down. Mark Dodge got just enough of his foot to trip him up. So Dodge, as usual, very active in the ball game and registering a couple of tackles already on this series.
And you mentioned the last name Thomas, his mother's maiden name. His grandmother passed away. It didn't look like he was going to be able to play against Missouri. So Coach Franchione said, you know what, go home. Go be with your family. And then during the bye week, he had an aunt on his mother's side pass away as well. So that's why Thomas is on the back of his jersey today.
Well, that pass by Colt McCoy, way overthrown. And McCoy knocked down after the ball was delivered by Kellen Hurd, a sophomore out of Wharton, Texas.
And, of course, Kellen Hurd was ejected from last year's ball game for a late hit on Colt McCoy. And that one, even though the hand was up near the face, that's not a late hit. And, you know, McCoy has that tendency sometimes to flop back and fall back. And sometimes I think that can be more dangerous than the actual hit itself. Sometimes you've got to take more of that hit.
Jamal Charles tries to get it to the outside, and he will finally be stopped at the 48-yard line. Now it's going to be third down, Texas, and they need to take it to the A&M 46-yard line. Kellen Hurd with his second tackle.
Well, if you're A&M, you're thinking Jermichael Finley. That's what Colt McCoy has been showing. A&M plays defense very similar to what Texas saw against Texas Tech. Safety's way back, so there's stuff open underneath. If I'm Texas A&M, I'd bring in an extra defensive back, which they have, and put a safety or a corner on Jermichael Finley, not a linebacker, because all he's going to do is probably run an out route.
Obanaya checks into the ball game at tailback, replacing Jamal Charles. McCoy gets the ball away, and unless he's got a receiver close by, that might be intentional grounding, as Henry Smith was all over it. It is fourth down, Texas. No flag on the play. And the Longhorns will have to punt. That was the ninth play of the drive.
Really good early on for A&M. A stunt in the middle. And good pressure so far. Yeah, you had, it looked like Nate Jones was in the neighborhood at least. But good pressure from the four. They have not had to blitz the Aggies, but a good stunt in the middle. And remember, this young, thin offensive line, Dallas Griffin, the senior out, Tony Hill's the senior out, so they may struggle with movement.
First punt of the afternoon for either team, and Justin Moore with a high-hanging spiral. Fair catch called for at the 10-yard line by Roger Holland, and that's where the Aggies will take it over. 8:42 left in the opening quarter, following a 42-yard boot. And A&M on top, 7-0.
Well, we are so used to seeing in this part of the country, if you've been following the Big 12, A&M come out and be a power running option, triple option team. Well, the drive before, we saw some screens. We saw some drop back passes, things that you really haven't seen much of this season. Let's see if Les Koenig, the offensive coordinator, and of course Dennis Franchione, who is in on the calls, is going to stay with that same plan. I don't know why they wouldn't.
We'd like to welcome those watching the Nebraska-Colorado game. Ron Franklin along with Ed Cunningham and Jack Arute. And our score with 8:20 left of the opening quarter is Texas A&M 7 and the Texas Longhorns nothing. It is a second down, and let's call it about 7.5 yards for A&M, and they have the ball just inside their own 15. Play back into the boundary, and that's Jaworski Lane. Bobineau defensively for Texas, number 44, got out there to make the hit, but he had some help from the secondary as well. Bobineau, who according to Les Koenig, the offensive coordinator for the Texas Aggies, had been watching a lot of video of him, that Bobineau has had a sensational year.
And watch number 98 Brian Arakpo get up the field and go completely unblocked. That was a missed assignment by Yemi Babaloa. And that's too much speed on that side. They've run the option a couple of times at Arakpo. Boy, he's an awfully athletic guy. I think you might want to run it the other way.
Third down. They need to take it to the 21-yard line. Texas shows blitz off the left side, and here he comes. McGee all the way back in the end zone, and the ball is simply thrown away. And applying the pressure, number 40, Robert Killebrew, the senior out of Spring, Texas, just north of Houston.
And you see what Texas has done now. They've adjusted. They've already made an adjustment to their defense. They were dedicating so many guys to the run. Now Dwayne Aquina and Larry McDuff, the defensive coordinators, that time bring a zone blitz. And Texas A&M not able to pick it up. That's a good adjustment by the defensive coaches of Texas, knowing that A&M has gotten into a throwing pattern, so now they can start playing more throw defense.
Justin Brantley prepares to punt it away for the Aggies. First punt for them of the afternoon. And this is a good one. Good, long, hanging spiral. Cosby all the way back to the 28-yard line. Now picks up a couple of blocks, and he'll return it to the 38. So let's take a timeout. 7:35 left in this opening quarter. Texas A&M 7-0 over the Texas Longhorns. This telecast is available on ABC HD, presented by DLP HD TV. So following a beautiful punt by Brantley, Texas with a 10-yard return by Cosby and a scrimmage from their own 38. Big opening, 50, 45. Jamal Charles with his first long run of the afternoon is going to take it to the 43. Now let's take a look at the Texas starting offense presented by Sports Authority. Here's Roger Clements, former Texas All-American.
Thanks, Ron. The Longhorn attack is led by our ace, quarterback Colt McCoy, who's starting to look like Elway with his second half comebacks. Colt will be handing off to speed merchant Jamal Charles. Jamal has well over 600 yards rushing in his last three games. Up front is do-it-all Chris Hall. Leads this group looking to roll the Aggies in College Station this afternoon.
Roger Clemens, as I said, former great at Texas, also with the Boston Red Sox and, of course, the New York Yankees. First down, Texas, with Jamal Charles with his longest gainer of the afternoon. And Charles this time will go straight ahead for two and tackled by Henry Smith. Now let's take a look at the Texas A&M defensive starters. Here is play-by-play announcer Dave South. Ron, the defensive front, three seniors anchor that, Bryant, Harrington, and Smith. The linebackers are Toupe and Dodge, the secondary, another senior, Carpenter. The two linebackers, Toupe had a church mission before he came here. Dodge had 4 years in the military before he came to A&M. They're old men. Gary Darnell gives them their ARC memberships at the end of the game today.
All right, Dave South, longtime play-by-play radio announcer for the Texas Aggies. Thanks, Dave. We'll hear him one more time when he introduces their offense as well. Charles, left side, sandwiched between two defenders, but he'll have about 3 yards. Toupe, one of the men that comes over to make the tackle along with Jordan Pugh, another of the linebackers. So now third down, Texas, and they need about 3 for the first down.
Well, and you're in that territory if you're Texas, even though Jamal Charles is trotting off the field right now. So you think they're going to bring in maybe Obanaya for pass protection, but Obanaya's gotten to be a pretty good runner. So for A&M, the tough part is you're in that tweener distance. I would think some type of play action if you have Obanaya in the game.
This time Colt McCoy is under center, which is a rarity, and under pressure, breaks one tackle, tries to break another, and is going to be knocked out of bounds at the 37-yard line, short of the first down.
Again, excellent pressure by Michael Bennett.
Yeah.
And it's been a bunch of different guys up front.
Harrington also wound up applying pressure.
There's Bennett there working one-on-one. And what an excellent move that he threw on Trey Allen. That's a true freshman. Remember, Tony Hill's the normal player.
Sideline warning. Texas A&M. It's their first warning.
So Texas
A&M is going for it on fourth down.
And I think it's the right call because, again, you're in that tweener distance.
Have to take it to the 33-yard line of A&M to pick up the first. McCoy, and it's going to be a pooch kick. And A&M runs away from it, and the ball is going to go dead at the 17-yard line. So we'll take a timeout. 5:48 left. Opening quarter, our score remains Aggies 7 and the Longhorns nothing.
ESPN's College Football on ABC, presented by Best Buy. This holiday, we'll help you put together perfect gifts. Saturn, with 5 totally new models, it's just something to rethink about. Saturn. Pacific Life, for insurance, annuities, and investments, choose Pacific Life, the power to help you succeed. And Keystone Light, you can't always be smooth, but your beer should be.
Well, if you wonder what you're looking at, that's a very desolated College Station. No shots taken just a moment ago because the ball game has now started. There's nobody on the streets at College Station. They're all inside this stadium. And their Aggies lead it 7-0. Second time in a row that the Aggies have scrimmaged from deep in their own territory. And we'll see if they're able to get this one out and move the chains.
Texas A&M has been feeding off of the offensive line problems for Texas, and it's been the pass rush that really has gotten this game going for A&M, and see if their offense can feed off it once more. The offensive line, of course, with Dallas Griffin, the senior, out for the season with a knee. Tony Hills out with a broken ankle. Very young group, and right now it's not blitzes that's confusing them. It's just they're getting beat in one-on-one situations.
So from a shotgun formation, both Lane and Goodson in the backfield, they have gone option the last times that they have come in this formation, and that's what they do again, and shoved out of bounds is McGee. Now let's take a look at the Texas A&M starting offense presented by Sports Authority. Here again, Texas A&M radio play-by-play announcer Dave South.
Ron, it all starts on the offensive side with Stephen McGee, the quarterback, but we've got some seniors that have contributed. Fullback Chris Alexander, the wideouts are Urban Taylor and Terry Franks. There's a tight end, Joy Thomas. That offensive line is anchored by the likes of Wallace, Clark, Elder, and Yoder.
Thanks, Dave South. Third down, and they need about 7 yards. You need to take it out to the 27-yard line. And Goodson has been split out, so it's an empty backfield occupied only by quarterback Stephen McGee. Looks to throw. Got a quick hitter. Martellus Bennett, the tight end, and that's good for the first down. Now let's take a look at the Texas defensive starters. Here once again is Roger Clemens.
On defense, we've got Derek Loki and Frank Oakham. Great players, great students with a 4.0 averages heading to law school. The linebackers are Rashid Bobineau and tackling machine Scott Deary. Our last line of defense is manned by the team's hardest hitter, Marcus Griffin. And the best coach in college football, Mack Brown, is looking for an amazing seventh straight 10-win season.
Who's the Lord?
Roger Clemens and a couple of his young sons. It is first down A&M as they have the ball at their own 31-yard line. McGee stays in the pocket, throws complete. It'll be a short gainer just across the 34-yard line. Let's check on the sidelines again with Jack Aroo.
Well, Ron, Ed Cunningham is absolutely right. The coaches have challenged this makeshift offensive line for the Texas Longhorns, saying that they need to play better football. And what they meant by that is the rushes that are that are taking place are really starting to force Colt McCoy to go faster and not go through his reads, Ed. They just finally got, as you would say, got their heads handed to them by the coaches there just a minute ago.
Yeah, it's nothing. They're not. It's not that A&M's bringing difficult blitzes. It's just they're getting beat man to man.
Again, shotgun, and again they keep the quarterback right in the pocket. Throws right over the middle, has it complete to Taylor, and it's just short of the first down, I believe. It's checking in New York. Here is John Saunders. John,
Ron, a few of your folks watching saw this Verizon Wireless update. Most of the country did not. Darren McFadden, 16 yards, the only touchdown in a game against LSU. LSU's offense struggling with just two field goals and problems moving the ball. Mississippi State trailed by 14-0 in the fourth quarter, got 17 straight points to get their seventh win of the season. Ron.
All right, John. Third down and short. Jaworski Lane gets the handoff, and Jaworski will power his way to the 44-yard line. Adewego makes the tackle out of the secondary for the Texas Longhorns. And let's take a look at the X Factor presented by City.
Well, you have one of the best rushing defenses in the country in Texas, sitting there at 10th, and of course A&M comes into the game 19th in the country at almost 220 yards rushing. But even though that will be the X factor, and of course Jamal Charles getting going, it looks like that off week A&M decided to go back to some plan from last year, spread it a little more and let McGee throw it a few more times.
Jaworski Lane right up the middle, head down, has 5, has 10, counted off at 12 yards. As Lane got a head down, got a good block from the left side of that offensive front, Schneider, Elder, and Wallace, and Eddie Jones finally made the stop.
Well, a lot of seniors, a lot of fifth-year seniors on this offensive line, and that was an excellent job. And when you let Jaworski Lane, listen, he's not the fastest guy in the world. He's not going to run a whole lot of sweeps. But right there, unfortunately for Marcus Griffin, he finds out what happens when Lane doesn't have to make a move until 4 or 5 yards down the field. He's got to come a little lower on those legs.
Mike Goodson comes back in a tailback, but he is split out. He's not in the backfield, so it's an empty set with McGee. And McGee steps up and throws to Bennett, the tight end. He is close to a first down as he goes inside the 35, tackled by McElroy. Near the conclusion of today's game, we'll select a Chevrolet player of the game from each team. Chevrolet will make a $1,000 contribution to each university's general scholarship fund.
Jumping out early for that player of the game, Martellus Bennett. Such a fine tight end. We've seen so many good tight ends in the Big 12 this year, but Bennett, the team's leading receiver, if you get him involved early, it becomes more difficult for the defense to have to try to defend him.
McGee now 8 of 10 for 100 yards and a touchdown.
Now that was confusion in what they were doing. Goodson thought he was going into motion, so I believe you're going to end up with a procedure penalty on A&M. They didn't know what shift they were going to make.
Timeout, Texas A&M. It's their first time out of the half.
Well, they got it just in time before the penalty.
2:36 remaining, opening quarter. A&M remains on top, 7-0.
A Midwest border war, but never with this much in the balance. Surprise unbeaten Kansas takes on Missouri for a spot in the Big 12 championship game and a step towards reaching the BCS title. Number 2, number 4 on neutral turf in Kansas City. Tomorrow at 8 Eastern on Saturday Night Football.
Well, just before the timeout, Mack Brown walked all the way out on the field and asked one of the officials who called the timeout. He said, I saw the two flags, but I never saw a timeout. Halfback pass by Lane. Will he throw it?
Yes, he gets it away and he throws it out of bounds.
Good defense by Texas, but going to the Big 12, and who's going to be in the championship game? Well, the North is crystal clear. It's the winner tomorrow night between Missouri and Kansas. In the South, it's a little muddier. It's clear if Oklahoma wins tomorrow against Oklahoma State, which is a big if. Oklahoma State, one of the best offenses in the country, and Oklahoma with a ton of guys hurt, then Texas is back in it with a win today. If Texas wins and Oklahoma loses, Texas goes to the Big 12 championship game. And if both teams lose, it goes all the way to the BCS to decide who will be in the championship game.
Third down, about a yard and a half for A&M. Two tight ends. They give it to Lane. Big opening. Powers his way inside the 28 to the 26-yard line. Adewego making a stop out of the secondary, but a gigantic hole on the right side of the line. Really good job by that Aggie offensive front.
Adewego slow to get up. Safeties are starting to take a pounding from Lane. And this offensive line for A&M, which coming into the season, everybody in this conference thought that A&M would probably have the most dominant offensive line in the conference, if not in the country. I mean, you had seniors all over the place. Cody Wallace, Kirk Elder, Corey Clark, Chris Yoder. It's a very veteran group with a lot of starts. And when you get Lane going at nearly 270 pounds, he doesn't have to make a move right now. Right now, Texas is doing nothing to slow down Lane at the line of scrimmage.
And Adewego, as Ed mentioned, slow getting up and now being assisted off the field.
And we saw the run before where Javorski Lane ran right over Griffin, the other safety. So it looks like Adewego is just going to go straight into the locker room for an assessment.
Eric Jackson will come in replacing him at strong safety. This is the 11th play of the drive coming up for Texas A&M. It all started back at the 19-yard line. Mike Goodson in the backfield at tailback. A&M scrimmages with a first and 10 at their Texas 26-yard line. Option play. Goodson now going to be knocked out of bounds at around the 20-yard line. And let's go to the sideline to check in again with Jackaroo.
Ron, you know, rivalry week across the country, there's all sorts of rivalries. This is a very special one, though. There's a rivalry with respect. But for Coach Dennis Franchione, it might be his final rivalry game for Texas and Texas A&M. And this week he said he really tried to make it special for all of his seniors. One of the things that they did is they asked each and every senior at their last meeting to stand up and tell everyone who they wanted to dedicate this game to. They are feeding off their early success on the sidelines here right now, guys.
Second down and short situation as the Aggies have played virtually all afternoon in front of the sticks. They lead it 7-0 and threatening again with the ball inside the 20. McGee gets outside at the 15 and now is going to be tackled hard at the 14-yard line. Robert Killebrew got outside to make the hit, but that is another A&M first down.
What it looks to me like, you know, one of the criticisms through the years, through this season about Texas A&M was they got so conservative in the run game. We showed you they're the 19th best rush team in the country, but they're down around 106, 107th in the country out of 119 in the pass. And McGee, who has a good arm, it seems to me that off week, A&M went back to what people suspected they would do offensively this year, and the balance is really confusing Texas right now. That's not what they prepared for.
13th play of the drive coming up. Clock is about to hit 1:40 left to play in this opening quarter. McGee fakes it into the line. He'll keep it into the boundary, and he's going to be dropped for no gain on this play. It'll be second down and 10. Arakpo was there defensively.
The option is not working because of the speed on the outside of Texas. And when you see those inside runs, Javorski Lane, I know a lot of guys want to run through their script. You're not getting much on that action to the left. I think come off of that script and go back up the middle. Even if it is Goodson, Lane or Goodson, I think you're going to have much better success right now running right at Texas instead of around them.
Mike Goodson is the man at the top of your screen as we go wide. The tailback is set way out there. Looking, it appears, against single coverage by Zach Berry. Is that a linebacker?
Sure looks like it.
Looking, And he's going a little too tall for Joe Thomas, who cut underneath as Goodson had driven the linebacker back into the end zone and out of the play. But he missed Thomas completely. And it's going to be a third down at 10. Texas A&M.
And I think if you're A&M, you start thinking about the horrible field goal percentage you've had on the season. And you're at third and 10. To me, I think every time in this area, because they have been so bad in field goals this year, that I think every time you're down here, you're thinking about going for it on fourth. So you could run a draw here, a very conservative call, because you may go for it on fourth.
Szymanski is only 13 of 23 in field goal attempts. It's Goodson in motion as they really spread out that Texas defense. McGee pass over the middle, ball is tipped and it's incomplete. It'll be fourth down, and from where the line of scrimmage is, this would be 32, maybe 33 yards. Yep. Bobineau got a hand on that ball and tipped it.
Bobineau working one-on-one with Michael Schumart, but we were just talking about Matt Szymanski, a very highly recruited kicker who from 30 and beyond is only 6 of 16 on the season. So these are not automatic.
31-yard attempt coming from the far hash mark. Gets a good pass and he got it. Crowd holding their breath there for a moment as he put it right over the top of the outside goalpost, and it is good. 10-0, our new score. Texas A&M leading the Texas Longhorns. We'll be right back. Some of the Corps of Cadets down on the sideline with the towels for the 12th man, which of course is a tradition that has been here for a long, long time in this campus. And in fact, across the way on the side of the stadium, the big sign reads, home of the 12th man. Cosby from the 8-yard line. Cosby 25 at the 30 and then is shoved out of bounds there. And let's go down and check in again with Jack Arute.
Hey, Ron, if you ask Colt McCoy the two most important games on the schedule for him, well, it's Texas Tech and Texas A&M, mostly because of family ties, but also because of what happened 1 year ago up in Austin, Texas, when Colt McCoy early in the game was pasted. And he was suffered with a neck injury, and he was carted off the field. It gave rise to an entire speculation of nicknaming him here, Cart McCoy. And he said, well, they want to see how tough I am? Have him come to the game this year.
Jamal Charles is going to take that one for a gain of maybe a yard, and Michael Bennett is there defensively.
It was Bennett, obviously, who knocked McCoy out of the game last year up in Austin. A clean hit. There was a not-so-clean hit earlier in the game that knocked Kellen Hurd, got ejected from the game, but Colt McCoy spent the offseason. He had the stinger coming into that game from the Kansas State game and really tried to fight. Jevin Snead had already said he was going to transfer. He knew he had to play and just wasn't quite ready for it.
Quick pass and quarter had come
quarter
to an end.
Before the snap, it's the end of the first quarter.
So we will take a timeout, and as we head to the second 15 minutes of play, the opening 15, well, it was all Texas A&M. They lead it 10-0 as we head into the second quarter.
Dale Hansen, Sports News 8 Now.
Welcome back to College Football on ABC, presented by Best Buy. Texas with a second down and whistles and a flag thrown from across the way. And now another flag is tossed down.
Well, I don't think that they had set the ball ready for play, but that's the umpire who needs to walk
delay
up.
Delay game on the offense. The ball was snapped before the Whitney for play. It's a 5-yard penalty. Repeat second down.
Well, I don't put that on Buck Burnett, the center. The umpire did not stay near the ball. Typically what the umpire will do is stand over the ball. That's exactly what Mac Brown is saying. That's a tough call to get 5 yards in before the snap when the umpire was not up over the ball saying don't snap it, wait till I back out. He was already in position, so Buck Burnett, the center, of course is going to get on the ball and snap it. I don't blame Mac for being upset.
Well, he's a little hot. screen pass. And here's Charles, and Charles looking for a little open space. He'll take this one out to around the 37-yard line. Mark Dodge tripped him up.
Well, it's been just a sensational end part of the season for Jamal Charles. And you go back to that middle part of the season where Charles had issues with fumbles, but he has been so explosive. Now out again, that third and short. I think they need to start leaving Charles in there, even if it's just for a decoy of a run play.
Quick toss in and out of the hands of Finley, the tight end. JerMichael Finley could not hold on, and it is a fourth down situation.
Well, and that was good coverage by Mark Dodge. Even if Finley makes the catch, I think Dodge maybe makes the tackle right where he catches it. So A&M's defense has been sensational. Third punt of the game for Texas. A&M came in here. They played so many good offenses of late. They're playing as well as anybody could expect.
Justin Moore prepares to punt it away. Roger Holland, the deep man for the Aggies, he's dropped off all the way back to the 20-yard line. 10-0, Texas A&M leads it. Wobbly spiral off the side of his foot, and it's going to come dead. Going to roll down to the 24-yard line.
Well, Mark Dodge is wearing Thomas, his mother's maiden name, on the back of his jersey. A few weeks ago, before Missouri, he was banged up, may not have played, and then his grandmother passed away. The funeral was on the Friday of the Missouri game, so he didn't travel. Then during the bye week, last week, his aunt on his mother's side passed away. So the senior, he's part of that Geritol gang. He's 26 years old. It's been 4 years in the military, honoring his aunt and his grandmother with his mother's maiden name instead of Dodge on the back of his jersey.
That was Gary Darnell, the defensive coordinator he was visiting with down on the sideline. Aggies have it first and 10 at their own 24. McGee, like he was going to run an option, goes back, throws to his tight end, Martellus Bennett, and Bennett is going to be stopped after a gain of about 3 as the ball came out. But did it go out of bounds?
Yes, it did, and Bennett was trying to move that ball around.
McElroy.